The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... I'm E.G. Marshall. It is said that fine feathers do not make fine birds. It is also claimed that you cannot judge a book by its cover. Unfortunately, both these trenchant observations have been consigned to the limbo of wise sayings that are constantly being disregarded. Birds, books, and even people are always being judged by their appearance. The sad truth is that the overwhelming majority of us will choose a beautiful fool over a homely philosopher. Well, that's life. And sometimes, that's death.
Did you kill him?
Well...
Never mind well. Did you kill him? Answer yes or no.
I'm not sure.
What do you mean you're not sure?
I really don't know.
Did you buy a knife?
Yes.
Are those your fingerprints on the knife?
Yes.
Then how can you deny that you killed him?
I admit it. Looks bad for me, Mars.
Bad? It looks terrible.
The only thing that makes me doubt that I'm a murderer... No, I can't tell you.
You must tell me.
Well, promise not to laugh.
I promise.
Mars, there is one thing I could never do. Now you have to believe me. I could never kill a man who wore a pink shirt.
Our mystery drama, The Rape of the Maia, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Arnold Stang and Norman Rose. It is sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Said Henry David Thoreau, of all enterprises that require new clothes. That was all very well for Henry T., who liked to live single-o at Walden Pond, where he could commune with frogs and flowers and field mice. My Lord, if everybody had that attitude toward new clothes, what would happen to a certain little world that lies within the confines of Manhattan Island, a universe in microcosm, which is simply known as 7th Avenue. But enough philosophy. You tune us in for action. We'll give you action. A most beautiful young girl is walking down 7th Avenue near 37th Street. She is clad in a stunning, shimmering, flowing dress. It is a dress to inflame the imagination and arouse the passions. And here is a young man who has been obviously aroused and inflamed because, without warning, he grabs her.
Let go of me! Who are you? What?
That's mine. Now, that is mine.
Take your hands off
that
me.
That gown. Where did you get that gown?
Oh, scream.
Take that dress off. It's mine.
Help! No,
don't scream.
There's a maniac. Help me.
Now, just listen. Oh, listen, you fool.
You're joking me.
Yes, I'm joking you. I have to make you stop screaming. Now, look, you're an intelligent girl. Now, you must promise to be good. No. Now, don't open your mouth. Just listen. I'm going to let go of you. See? Now, take off that dress.
Thank you, officer. I shall call when I require your services again.
I'll kill him. I'll destroy him utterly.
Vaughn, it's too early in the morning to talk about killing.
He stole the Maia. He stole the Maia.
All right, so he stole the Maia.
Oh, sure, you can say, all right. Is the Maia your inspired vision? Was the Maia distilled from your blood? You fat Philistine.
I'm trying to lose weight.
I shall assassinate that depraved thief.
You'll be out of here by lunchtime.
I'll let out his heart's blood.
Now, Vaughn, we have to get back to work. The show is in 13 days. I need another design.
Morris. How can you speak of new designs? I lie here violated, ravaged, distraught.
Give me something I can produce for $49.95.
Leave me, Morris, with my grief.
A simple little frock with a collar. Vaughn, what do you think about a collar?
Oh, that viper. That viper. I allowed him to sit at my feet, basking in the rays of my creativity.
I got it. Let's bring back the Peter Pan collar.
And that infamous wretch plunges a poison dagger into my back.
Vaughn, listen to me. The reason you're getting off easy, I saw that girl's father last night. I thought if I would explain to him about the Maia...
The rape of the Maia.
How you designed this gorgeous dress, and for only $39.95.
Be my witness, Myers. The dagger he plunged into my back is the dagger I shall thrust into his heart.
But I take a look at the father, a giant, a hard hat. When I say who I am, he says, "What do you want?" I'm telling you, if looks could kill, I'd be a corpse.
To design the Maia. Maia, daughter of Atlas and Diana. I was inspired by the ancient gods themselves.
But I explained to him how you created such a masterpiece and had it stolen from you by your best friend.
No.
Who turns around and sells it to another manufacturer. Why, this big giant, you know what? He just sat down and cried.
Through the heart. Through his false, perfidious heart. I shall stab him.
So, no charges, everything's fixed.
I shall rid the world of an abomination that calls itself Perry Fullerton.
You come right back to work this afternoon.
I shall never take pencil in hand again. Leave me with my grief.
All right. God! You know, Vaughn, when I heard that you were arrested for attacking a girl, I... Well, how could I believe it? Sally Jo, I have to talk to you.
Oh, well.
Sally Jo, I'm in trouble.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, sugar.
What I mean is real trouble.
Oh, I'm genuinely sorry to hear that.
Oh, it's a bad scene. Oh, it's total trouble.
Oh, Perry, honey.
Have you seen Adrian?
Adrian?
Yes, if Adrian finds me, I'll...
Harry, sugar, now why should you be scared?
I need $500, like right now.
But you got $500. You took that adorable little Maya dress over to the man at Personality Fox, and he gave you $500 in nice new bills.
He did.
Well, then you have the $500.
Well,
Well, what?
He don't have the $500.
Adrian.
Yeah, it's Adrian.
Sally Jo, what is he doing here?
What am I doing here? I pay the rent, that's what I'm doing here.
Well, now that's not really true.
It ain't. Perry owes me $500, so he's paying your rent with my money.
Adrian, let me explain.
What's to explain? You just come up with five big bills which you owe me. Dig into them green pants of yours.
They're aqua.
And hand over the dough.
Well, I had the money. I
don't like where this is headed.
But you know, do you know the shoddy way they make things
you
today?
You ain't gonna like it either.
Well, there's a hole in my pocket, you see? And the money just slipped out.
I'll tell you where the dough slipped out. You stopped off on the way down here. You laid the whole $500 on some nag.
That's not true.
The race is over, but your nag is still running.
Now, Adrian, don't press me.
You see this little slip of paper? Read it.
Nobody pushes me around.
Everybody pushes you around, punk. Read what it says on the paper.
Maia, 500, PF. Well?
That's your marker. You put 500 on her nose and she come in dead last.
Maia! How could a horse named Maia lose? Vaughn and I designed a gown called Maia.
Vaughn and you? Oh, now, sugar.
Oh, you're always trying to put me down, Sally. Oh, you... Vaughn warned me about
you. Shut up. She's on your side. She showed you how to raise 500 by stealing the dress design. But a natural-born sucker like you can't pass by a betting parlor or a bookie. You must have dropped the whole 500.
I told you there was a hole in my pocket.
The money burned the hole in it. You treat yourself pretty good on my dough, don't you? Punk, you must have paid 50, 60 bucks for that red shirt.
It's pink, flamingo pink.
You don't make a sucker out of me.
Adrian, sugar, you're raising your voice.
This punk, I'm going to kill him.
That
That won't get you your $500.
It'll get me something else, satisfaction.
Adrian, you can't afford to kill a person just for satisfaction.
Why not? Why can't a guy do something just because he wants to? I'm human. I got needs.
Adrian.
Hey, now, you've got to fold up that knife.
Adrian. Hey,
you don't want to kill me.
But I do.
I'll pay you.
You ain't never gonna pay me.
No, but I will. I swear I will.
You had the money.
I know. And on the way down here, well, I heard about a good thing in the Fifth at Starlight Park. At 8-1. Oh, his name was Clothes Horse. Can you imagine? Clothes Horse. And I'm a designer.
You're an assistant designer.
So, I thought, well, I'd have enough to pay you back plus. Clothes Horse. Oh, if you were me, wouldn't you bet your life on Clothes Horse?
You know what you are. You are a hunchbetter.
Oh, yes, indeed. I am a hunchbetter.
You know what happens to hunchbetters? They die broke, you understand?
Oh, yes, indeed. I do. They die broke.
So, as long as you're broke, why shouldn't you die now?
No, I swear to you, Adrian, I'll get that money. I'll pay you back, only please... Please don't kill me.
Why then? How can a soft-hearted guy like me expect to get anywhere in this world?
Oh, believe me, Adrian. Yeah, forget what you hear. Nice guys do finish first.
So, I ain't gonna kill you.
And you won't regret it. I'll pay you back every cent.
But just to make sure you remember, I'm gonna carve a little mark.
No. No, you keep away.
On the right side of that chin of yours.
Adrian, no.
Stand still.
No, I won't.
Don't try to fight him, Perry. Now, don't.
Let go of my arm, punk.
No, I won't let you kick me.
I said let go.
No, don't. Don't kill him.
Hold still. You're getting off tape.
You killed him.
I told him to stand still. It was his own fault.
Oh, the blood. Look at that blood all over his shirt.
Who's that?
Open up, Perry Fullerton. I know you're in there. Open the door and face me.
Keep still or go away.
The door.
What about the door?
Perry Fullerton, you have raped the Maia. You shall reap the whirlwind.
The door, it isn't locked. Oh, what do we do if he turns the knob?
In this package, I have a gift for you. Come, let me look at your face as I unwrap it.
Perry Fullerton, you forgot to lock your door against fate. You're a dead man.
Why, he just fainted.
You know this creep?
Well, sure, of course. His name is Vaughn.
Oh, not anymore, it ain't. It's just been changed.
It has.
To Patsy. Leave me make a few arrangements.
Thank you. Thank you, officer. Tell me, isn't this where I came in? Vaughn, you know what they say. They say you killed him.
Yes.
The door was open. A neighbor passed by. They say you were lying there, unconscious, on the floor next to him.
Yes.
The knife. The knife with the switchblade, with blood on it, was in your hand.
Yes.
They say you had the motive.
Yes.
And so, when you add all this together, it proves you killed him. That's what they say.
Yes, Morris, that's what they say.
But, Vaughn, you know what I say. I say I don't believe a word they say.
Why, Morris? Why?
Because I believe you're innocent. I refuse point blank to believe them.
No, Morris. Believe them.
What are you saying? Why should I believe them?
Because they happen to be right. I'm guilty.
Guilty? Vaughn, how can you even say such a thing?
Because, Morris, it's true.
Oh, no. No, not you.
I killed him.
I can't believe it. How could a person like you kill another human being?
What a pointed and pertinent question. How could Vaughn have done it? Especially since we were present and know full well how matters went. The usual procedure is for the guilty to claim innocence. Here, on the other hand, is an innocent who claims guilt. Well, that's why we have a second act. So we can turn the screw even tighter. was the name of the ancient Greek goddess of fertility. Maia is also the name of a sleek 3-year-old racehorse who is still considered a maiden, meaning she hasn't won yet. And finally, Maia is the name of a beautiful gown designed by Vaughan Lemaire. Well, the goddess named Maia inspired the gown, but the racehorse named Maia inspired a losing bet, which produced a chain of circumstances, the latest link of which finds our poor Vaughan Lemaire in prison, charged with murder.
Listen, Vaughan, a nut you probably are, but a murderer, definitely not.
Oh, how little we know the inner heart of another human being.
Don't start up with me, Vaughan, I know you.
Oh, Morris, Morris, like Diogenes, you seek so desperately for the minuscule speck of what is good in man.
Did you kill him?
Did I kill him?
Say yes or no.
Yes.
I don't believe it. Look me in the eye and say yes.
Yes.
I still don't believe it.
Why? Why won't you believe
it? Will you stop being stubborn? You want to sit in the electric chair? You didn't kill him, and that's all there is to it.
Morris, accept reality.
You talk to me about reality.
Oh, poor Morris, the eternal optimist. You so desperately want to believe in the essential goodness of man, but man is evil. The flesh is wicked. I have the brand of Cain, the murderer's mark.
What are you talking about? How could you kill anybody? You faint at the sight of blood.
Yes, that's true. But you don't see the blood until afterward.
Okay. Okay, Mr. Wise Guy. Wind up in the chair with the wires and the metal cap.
I decided to kill him. I purchased the knife. I went to the apartment, and I killed him. You must accept it, Morris.
No.
Oh, poor Morris. Poor, loyal, loving Morris.
You mean you killed him? You really actually killed him?
Now, please, you mustn't feel so badly.
I'll get you a lawyer.
Now, please, Morris, not your son-in-law.
Sheldon's a wonderful lawyer.
I don't want a wonderful lawyer.
Why not?
He might get me acquitted.
That would be bad.
I'm guilty. I must pay for my crime.
Vaughan, is there anything you need?
Solitude. I must compose the speech.
What speech?
When the judge will say, Vaughan Lemaire, do you have anything to say before sentence is passed upon you? I intend to be ready.
I tell you, Vaughan, after they made you, they threw away the model. Lieutenant Valentine.
What can I do for you, Mr.?
Goodman. Morris Goodman of Goodman Originals. We're almost neighbors. I hate to bother you in the middle of a working day.
Oh, that's perfectly all right, Mr. Goodman. We at your police department are public servants, constantly at your disposal.
It's about Vaughan Lemaire.
Oh, yes, yes. Vaughan Lemaire. Are you a blood relative?
Well, I'm closer than that. He's my designer.
Well, how may I help you?
Well, I just can't believe he would commit a murder.
Why can't you believe?
Well, because...
Because people we know do not commit murder, correct? Murderers are subhuman, evil strangers.
But he's such a gentle person. He's crazy, maybe, but...
Yes, but there's an extensive literature on the subject. Now, are you familiar with Kowalewski's theory of supportive denial?
No, I'm not sure.
Well, in a situation where the accused is an outwardly gentle, law-abiding person who does not fulfill the normal stereotype of the psychotic with homicidal tendencies, his immediate personal community will weave a protective web.
Yes, I think I understand.
Yes, to protect the murderer, yes, but also to protect their own emotional investment in him.
Yes, but even so...
Well, our faith in a cause, in a belief... In another human being dies hard. But fact, as Trevelyan wrote, is usually the killer of faith. So, motive? Under Perry Fullerton's body, this slip of paper. Please read it.
Maia, 500, P.F.
A note to himself. Now, he could get $500 from PF, personality frocks, for the Maia, which he did.
Yes.
The knife itself, switchblade, bloodstained, and with his fingerprints on the handle.
Tell me, what's in that box?
The one with the gift wrapping. It looks like something he bought at Julio's down the street.
Inside this gift wrap box was nothing.
Why would he bring a gift wrap box with nothing inside?
For a symbolic reason. Perhaps because what he was truly bringing Perry Fullerton was death.
Yes, yes.
And finally, this document, his confession, fully and freely given, in which he admits the murder. Well, Mr. Goodman?
To
prove murder, we must show the accused is guilty beyond the shadow of a doubt. Now, are you still in that shadow, Mr. Goodman?
No. No, you're right. I didn't want to believe it, but how long can I insist the earth is flat? Thank you, Lieutenant. Thank you, officer.
Morris!
I came over as fast as I could. Now, what is the matter, Vaughn? You're so excited.
Morris, I'm being framed.
For what?
For murder. I didn't kill Perry Fullerton.
But yes, you did.
Who says so?
Who? You! You convinced me that you killed him. The knife? The fingerprints?
I thought I killed him.
You thought? How could you think?
Because I was making a natural assumption.
Oh, is that so?
I had every intention of killing him. Therefore, I went to Julio's. I purchased a knife. I went to the apartment. The next thing I knew, I was lying there beside his dead body on the floor, the knife in my hand. And so, wouldn't it be natural to assume that I had accomplished my mission and killed him?
Yes, yes, it would be natural.
But this morning, as I awoke from troubled slumber, I realized that I did not kill him.
How could you realize?
That when I walked inside the door, he was already lying dead on the floor, and I fainted at the sight of the blood.
No, Vaughn. You convinced me the other day.
Two people were standing there in that room.
Oh, yes, I know. And they had just gotten off from a flying saucer. Now, please, Vaughn.
I didn't kill him. Sally Joe. You know Sally Joe. She used to be our model. I fired her because she became obese.
Oh, maybe she put on a little weight, but obese.
He was standing there with Adrian.
Vaughn, who could believe such a story?
A person who calls himself my friend could believe it.
I can't keep up with you. One day you're guilty, the next day you're innocent.
All right. Let me prove it to you that I am innocent. I went to Julio's to purchase the knife. It was a Damascene blade.
Oh, please.
This was to be the most artistic and exquisite killing in the entire history of personal assassination.
Ooh, even when you talk about a knife, it makes me...
I would confront him and I would say, I have a gift. I shall unwrap it. I shall present it. Point first. And I would. But I fainted. You yourself, you know I faint at the sight of blood.
Sheldon says it won't be too bad. You can plead temporary insanity.
But you see, I couldn't have killed him unless and until I could make him change his shirt.
Now, what is this?
Morris, his shirt was flamingo pink. His blood was bright red. Well, truthfully, the sight of that atrocious clash in colors is what made me pass out.
But as you said yourself, the blood you don't see till afterwards.
No, Morris, not I. Had he been alive when I entered the flat, had I held the knife to his breast, I would have seen the red blood before it gushed forth to stain the pink shirt. I, a designer, see things before they exist.
Well, then, Vaughn, how...
Morris! Have you ever known me to mix pink and red? Have you? Oh, I'm ill. I just can't think of it.
Vaughn, will you please shut up? A person can't hear himself think.
Morris, have I ever lied to you?
Oh, constantly. I don't mind. It's part of your genius.
I wanted to kill him. I bought the knife, but I never even unwrapped the package. He was dead when I got there. I'm innocent, Morris.
Vaughn.
Believe me, Morris. You must believe me.
I understand, Mr. Goodman, and there is also an extensive literature on that subject.
Is that so, Lieutenant?
Have you read Feuerbacher on Immaculate Cancellation?
Well, I couldn't be sure.
Unwilling to face the fact of murder, the worst of crimes, the subject will cancel the memory and thus cleanse himself of guilt.
What you're saying is he's telling a lie.
Because he cannot face the enormity of the deed.
One thing he said made sense. He couldn't stab a man who was wearing a bright
pink shirt. The colors would clash.
You're saying he wouldn't violate his artistic principles?
Yes. Yes, that's what I'm saying.
Why not? He was willing to violate his moral ones.
I believe him.
Here is the knife with his fingerprints.
I know, but yet he says he brought it there in that box and never even took it out.
Fingerprints, bloodstains. These are the facts which tell us otherwise.
The knife. Now, wait. It's a switchblade knife, no?
Yes.
It's not what you would call highly artistic?
No, but you would call it highly effective.
This? This is the knife he bought?
Why not? It's good enough to do the job.
You lied to me.
I swear to you, Morris, I told you the truth.
What is this nonsense about an artistic knife? With a damaged, whatever you call it, blade.
It's true.
I saw the knife. It had your fingerprints on
it. Somebody placed them there while I was unconscious.
It was a common, ordinary, everyday switchblade knife that any common, ordinary, everyday hoodlum would use.
Impossible. Here, I'll show you. I have the sales slip from Julio. Well, I don't have it with me. They took everything out of my pocket.
Fawn, please, you should really tell me the truth.
But it's true. Ask Julio. He'll tell you. Just ask Julio.
You know, Juan, he walks up the island, down the island, pound his fist on the counter. He's going to kill Perry Fullerton. Can I sell him a knife?
And so you sold him a knife. Oh, Julio, how could you sell him a knife? He was behaving like a maniac.
Morris. How can you say such a thing about me?
But you did sell him the knife. You knew he was ready to kill, and you sold him a knife.
I sold it to him, and I didn't sell it to him.
At the same time?
At one and the same time.
You realize we're discussing a physical impossibility?
Listen to how clever I did it. He picks out this dagger. Genuine. Made in Toledo. Not Ohio. Spain.
Mm-hmm. Continue.
And he wants it gift wrapped.
This much I know without you.
What you don't know is how I gift wrap it. I gave it to Regina.
Oh, she still works? I thought she got married.
And the receipt. I write the letters COP.
Mm. Cop. That's spelled cop.
It also stands for cooling off period. When I sell an angry person a weapon, I make sure he don't walk out of the store with it so he can commit murder on the spot.
So what do you do?
I give the signal to Regina not to put it in the box. So she gift wraps an empty package. A day or two later, the customer comes back, but he ain't angry enough to kill anybody anymore.
So what you're telling me is he walked out of here without the knife.
Hey, great idea, Morris, no?
So he never used it to kill Perry.
How could he use it to kill Perry? Still in the store.
Then he was telling me the truth. He didn't kill Perry. But how is such a thing possible?
Well, you knew it all along. But then, of course, you were there when it happened. Remember, Morris is trying to put it all together out of thin air. And he isn't even a police officer. What is Morris going to do to convince people of Vaughn's innocence? With ethereal characters like Vaughn, there's really nothing solid to hold on to. Yesterday, Vaughn was guilty. Today, he's innocent. Will the pendulum swing again tomorrow? We still have a third act. Perry Fullerton cheated two people. He stole a design from Vaughn Lemaire, and he welched on a bet he owed to bookmaker Adrian Smollett. Both Vaughn and Adrian were furious enough to kill him. And while Adrian committed the murder, poor Vaughn is getting the blame, thus proving the old proverb, the early bird gets the credit.
But, Lieutenant, he didn't even have a knife.
I'm afraid he did, Mr. Goodman. It's here on the table.
That isn't the knife he bought from Julio. Julio didn't put the knife in the package.
Precisely, Mr. Goodman. And when Vaughn discovered the package was empty, he picked up another knife, this knife, the bloodstained knife with his fingerprints on it.
But he swears that he saw Sally Joe Crabtree and Mr. Adrian Smollett. They were in the room, and Perry was already dead on the floor when he arrived.
There is an extensive literature on the subject, Mr. Goodman.
I should have known.
Have you heard Tillinghast on compulsive psychotic association?
No.
Well, I suppose you could say it means misery loves company. A man in trouble tries to involve others.
You say he's lying, huh?
He's fantasizing.
But he says he saw them.
We asked Miss Crabtree and Mr. Smollett to come in for questioning.
And what happened?
They were out of town these past 3 days. They only returned this morning.
Lieutenant, I am a judge of character. I tell you, and you heard it here first, that Vaughn Lemaire is not guilty.
Maurice.
Hello, Julio.
Maurice, when a man eats lunch, he should have a smile on his face.
With this weight on my heart, how can I have a smile on my face?
Vaughn?
Julio, he was like a son to me.
He was a good designer. I say that much for him. What do you mean was? You talk like he's dead. They're going to put him away, Maurice. He's so open and close.
While there is life, there's hope. But is that enough?
Hey, listen. Do you want to bet on a horse?
Did I ever bet on a horse in my life?
You tease, Maurice. That's the secret of keeping young. This is a horse you, in particular, should bet on.
Be good enough to explain why I should violate the principles of a lifetime.
Because of the horse's name. Yes, this horse is called Maia. M-A-I-A.
Hey, that was the name of Vaughn's design.
There is a horse called Maia also.
I never heard of him.
I think he's a horse.
You mean lady horses also run, along with the men?
That's why I understand.
Huh? Only in America?
No, Puerto Rico too.
A horse called Maia. I can't get over it.
Rakina, she read the papers a lot.
I always said she was an intelligent girl.
She read the one ads to find the job for her husband.
The actor.
The one ads are near the racing pages. And there, she sees a horse named Maia. He's going to race at Southern Gardens.
I never heard of it.
Me neither. He's somewhere in Louisiana.
Maia is also a racehorse.
Aha. Aha, what?
Well, right now it's only aha. Maybe later it'll be something else.
Morris, I swear to you, I did not kill him.
But he is dead.
Well, of course he's dead.
Then somebody had to kill him.
But it wasn't me.
Then who else could it be?
Are you asking me, Morris?
Is there somebody else sitting in this cell that I could ask?
Am I a detective?
Am I? For the last week, I haven't been in the shop even.
I don't know who could have killed him.
Tell me, did he owe money?
He's dead, and I must protect his name.
Then I say goodbye right now.
Morris. He didn't know what he was doing. You see, he was desperate. He needed $500. I refused him. That's why. That's why he stole the Maia.
Tell me, did he bet on horses?
Oh, can't we leave his memory green?
Yes or no?
Oh, yes. Morris, why this inquisition?
This man, this Adrian Smollett, what does he do?
I think he's a gambler.
Ah, now it fits. Now it's a perfect size 10.
What are you saying, Morris?
But my problem is, how do I sell it?
Be right with you, sugar. Oh, it's Morris.
May I come in?
Well, certainly, Morris.
Well, it's, a very nice-looking place.
Thank you, Morris.
I haven't had a chance yet to say how sorry I am about Perry. After all, you and Perry...
Thank you again, Morris. You're so sweet.
I wonder, could you do me a small favor?
Why, I'd be delighted, Morris.
Well, you see, this is something new to me.
Well, you sound like a man who's going to attempt something naughty.
Oh, well, Sally Joe, for me, it would be naughty. I think I want to bet on a horse.
Maurice.
Well, shouldn't a man have some fun from life?
Well, absolutely.
I was reading in the papers, and I saw the name of a horse. It runs somewhere
I don't know, way down in the South.
Oh, honey, they're the best.
A horse named... You know, I can't get over it. Could you believe the name of this horse?
Well, sugar, I'd have to know it first, wouldn't I?
Maia.
Maia. But that's...
That's what?
Oh, nothing. It's just a coincidence.
Isn't it? True, it was stolen. No, let us not say that. He's dead, poor Perry. Let him rest. Anyhow, it was Vaughn's greatest design. And now... I see a horse named Maia. Isn't this fate?
Let me see the paper, sugar. Oh, yeah, here she is at Southern Gardens. Oh, my goodness, she's running at 32 to 1.
Is that a fact? So let me see now. For $500...
$500?
I should get back $16,000. Well, it'll make up a little bit for what we lost on the Maia.
You want to bet $500?
Is it too small a bet?
No. I think it's just fine.
I was wondering if you could do me a favor.
Oh, yes, of course, a favor.
Well, you see, I don't know any bookmakers. I mean, after all...
Oh, I understand.
So I was wondering if you...
Well, certainly. Certainly. You want me to call one?
On the telephone? It's like a taxi cab.
Oh, well, it's the easiest thing doing. You just pick up the phone and there you get right through. Now, you hold on just a minute.
Yeah?
Sally Joe. A gentleman's here. Wants to place a little bet.
A jump.
18 carat.
Good for the dough.
A very solid individual.
Put him on.
Morris?
Oh, yes, thank you. Hello? With whom am I speaking?
That don't matter. Just say your piece.
There's a horse called Maia.
Running into fifth at Sutton Gardens, 32 to 1 and carrying 106 pounds. How much you want?
Will $500 be all right?
To win?
Of course to win. What then, to lose?
Most times in 10 minutes. 500 on Maia. What's your initials?
Morris Goodman, M.G.
Stay near that phone, I'll call you back.
It's for you, sugar. Answer it.
Hello, Morris Goodman speaking.
She ran out of the money.
Well, what does that mean?
It means you lose.
Oh.
It also means you gotta pay me 5 big bills.
Yeah, I understand.
You got it on you?
Would I bet if I didn't?
You are a man in a million. Stay there, I'll be right over.
Coming.
You got my 500?
What a business. How quick money changes hands.
You're new, huh? You got my 5.
Let me ask you a question.
Yeah?
How could you prove I made such a bet?
I got it written down.
You write down every time somebody makes a bet with you.
Don't you keep a record in your business who owes what?
Well, I got an accountant. I keep books. What have you got?
I got slips.
Slips?
Slips of paper.
Ah.
Do you deny you made the bet?
Oh, no, I made it.
Then hand over my 5.
Could I see my slip first?
What do you want it for?
Oh, a souvenir.
Okay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Maia, 500 MG. Huh. It's an expensive slip of paper.
Yeah. Come on, Morris. Hand over my dough.
You are under arrest, Adrian.
What?
Sugar.
What kind of joke?
It's no joke. I'm serious.
You chump. Did you ring in a cop on me?
Sugar, it's Morris Goodman.
I am making what is known as a citizen's arrest. Any citizen is
entitled. Listen, I don't like this. Give me my dough or you're going to like it a lot less.
I am arresting you for the murder of Perry Fullerton.
Hey, wait a minute.
Now, you want to be careful, Mr. Goodman.
Listen, Morris, I can take a joke.
You were here and you killed him.
You're crazy.
Vaughn says he saw both of you here.
Why shouldn't he say that?
It's his word against ours.
We were in Atlantic City.
Well, you make sure you can prove it. Where did you stay, huh? With whom? Have you got receipts, tickets?
I think I'm gonna have to take care of this junk.
Don't be crazy, Hadrian. What can he prove?
I can prove that this slip of paper of yours is exactly the same as the one that was found on the floor under Perry Fullerton's body. It's the exact same paper, the exact same handwriting.
yours.
Oh, I gotta kill this clown now.
Lieutenant Valentine thinks it's a note Perry wrote to himself. He thinks Maia 500PF means personality frocks would pay him $500 for the Maia. But this is a bet slip. Your slip. P.F. is Perry Fullerton.
He's too smart, too smart.
You can't kill him here.
No, we'll take him someplace quiet. All right, you get moving, chump, and don't make a noise.
You certainly have enough knives.
Just stay close to me and shut up.
Where's everybody going?
Look out for him, Julio.
He's no trouble. You saw Morris with one hand.
What are we doing?
We're making a citizen's arrest.
Hey, that's fun. We should do this more often.
No, thanks. Once is enough for me. Lieutenant, how fast can I get Vaughn out? He has to get back to work.
Oh, the papers won't take more than half an hour.
Our fall showing is less than a week away.
Tell me, Mr. Goodman, how were you able to perceive the salient facts? How could you, in the face of all this apparent evidence, believe that Vaughn was innocent?
Well, Lieutenant, how could he mix red with pink?
There must have been something else.
Well, Lieutenant, there's an extensive literature written on the subject. Have you ever heard the poem that says, "Let me clasp his hand and call him friend, and I'll stand by his side till the bitter end"?
Who wrote that?
Who do you think? Morris Goodman.
This has been a story of friends. Friends who were loyal and friends who were false. Friends. They make living possible, but also can make living impossible. The book tells us that a faithful friend is the medicine of life. And while medicines cure, they can also kill. Friends, for better, for worse, who can do without them? Since we cannot do without you, I shall be back in just a few moments. Vanity of vanity, said the preacher. All is vanity. And our story was based on one of mankind's greatest vanities, the adornment of the body. And yet, is it so sinful for a woman to wish to appear lovely? After all, isn't a well-dressed woman sweeter to look upon? Besides, it gives gainful employment to so many people. And it has given us a subject for a tale of murder. Our cast included Arnold Stang, Norman Rose, Jackson Beck, Earl Hammond, and Joan Shea. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
It's coming from this room.
Mrs. Parker!
Open up! Open up in there!
Break it in! Break it in! Mrs. Parker! Mrs. Parker!
No! Oh, no!
Open the window!
Let me! Lock from the inside. Door locked on the inside, too. Key in the lock.
Mrs. Parker! Oh, let's get her to the window. Fresh air.
No, no. Don't bother. She's dead.
But maybe if we can get some air into her lungs.
It won't cure a broken neck.
Broken.
You can see the way it's twisted, Miss Hall. It's broken, all right.
Then she's been murdered, too.
Yes, Miss James. She's been murdered, too.
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.